Welcome to Dance to Heal. I'm your host, Jenny C. Cohen. Join me as I share stories of how dance and movement can bring healing in a way that is safe and tailored to your life. I'm a cancer survivor, mother of two, and an award-winning performer who found that movement was vital to my recovery. I created Dance to Heal Wellness and also authored the best-selling book, Outside in Recovery, Dancing My Way Back to Myself After Breast Cancer. I will bring new techniques to help you on your dance journey and healing path. Are you ready to move? Dance to Heal starts now. Welcome to today's show. I'm very excited that I was able to get today's special guest. She's on tour, and she was kind enough to come and do this interview in spite of her very hectic schedule. If you logged into the show description, you know who I'm talking about, but I'm not going to talk about that yet. I need to tune into this whole podcast, why I spent the time and the money to produce this. A lot of it had to do with when I was going through my treatment for breast cancer back 2014 and then recovery ever since 2015 to now. There were many modalities that I just had to start finding, because when the doctors released me from after radiation and the 6 months, they do 6 months checkups the first 2 years, and then they kind of say, well, we'll just bring you down to a year. And then they go, oh no, you're done, you're good. And I'm going, what do you mean? I've been seeing you consistently for about 3 years now, and now you're saying I'm healed and you feel very lost. For those of us who have undergone any type of life-changing events, all right, let's be frank, even becoming a mother, you get pregnant, there's no little booklet that tells you what to do or become a parent, right? You kind of learn. Sometimes you might be a part of a group. Sometimes you have mother figures in your life or father figures or patriarchs and matriarchs that will help you a little bit, right? Because in this society, we kind of have to go it alone. And so Dance to Heal was born because the actual program was born because I've discovered in order to heal, I needed not much more. I needed movement. I needed trauma therapy. I needed yoga. I need a dance in a very general and also specific way. I was going to a lot of events during chemotherapy, radiation, 5 days after surgery. On another podcast, I'll tell you now. So 5 days after my surgery, it wasn't a full top surgery, but it was a major surgery. And I had to go to East Coast Classic, run by a very dear friend of mine named Nadira. And this event is in Virginia. And, you know, I had no hair. I just finished chemotherapy and I danced. And at the end of that performance, I got a standing ovation, but I didn't felt like I deserved it. So I started to back away. No. But I fell off the back of the stage because they didn't have a background. Zoe's like clutching her face. Yeah, I didn't, but they had chairs lined up. So I fell into the chairs and people who were standing up and giving me the applause thought I was trying to be funny. And I actually ended up hurting my leg really badly, but I sprung up and I said, thank you. And I walked off and it was just really interesting. The deep-rooted insecurities that will come up. So in the public eye, right, we're brave being a mother, being a survivor, being a cancer recovery person who makes it through to the end of treatment. And what we rarely talk about is how important it is to acknowledge how deeply scarred we are, you know, and the yearly memories of it, we have to just acknowledge. Yeah. Kind of like the loss of a person when you lose someone and that anniversary that of time you spent with them comes around every year. It's important to stop and take in the role they played and the loss of them or the loss of me prior to the cancer treatment and the new me that I have to celebrate and learn to know now. Yeah. So I invite you to do that. One of the key things that really helped me in my healing, and I'm going to bring that up specifically because my guest, she's a integral part of this very famous up and coming music group, or famous and always famous to me. If you don't know about them yet, you really need to get in with the times, people. But music and sounds affect our healing. In previous podcasts, I've spoken to you about that you don't necessarily have to have music to dance to. The sound of waves at the beach are my personal favorite. When my husband asks me, where do you want to go RVing? I go, can we have a site at the beach? Something about the waves and that consistent sound
is very comforting. And for me, it's very healing. But some of us, there's music that you prefer or that your innermost parts resonate with. Remember, our bodies are mostly water and we react to sound waves from music or sounds or even someone's voice. My secret dream is to be a singer because there's something about a singer's ability to reach deep down inside each of us, yeah? And kind of like hold your heart in their hand and kind of heal it with their voice. That's how I feel anyways. And you know what I'm talking about. In countries like Egypt, they have a very famous dancer, a singer by the name of Kalthoum. And she would transfix the entire country for hours at a time with just her voice. And I speak on that because have you ever listened in on a song or hear somebody passing by with their windows roll down and you hear that music and it just pulls you right back to the past, or it'll give you solace. One of my favorite songs is George Michael's Faith. I could listen to that song for hours on repeat because even if I'm really down the dumps, it lifts me up. If I'm really happy, it lifts me up. If I'm angry, somehow it releases me, makes me feel better. Like I'll be driving angry and I'll be screaming those words out. Can't sing them now. I just need the song to play. Music is so healing, or sound effects are an integral part of your healing. So enough about Jenny and her need for you to play music or sounds. For the remainder of this podcast, I invite you to tune into your five senses and be present with us. We've done this before in the past, but think about your taste. So for my taste, you know, you know me and my handy dandy Earl Grey tea, because the bergamot oil is wonderful antidepressant natural look. My therapist has whiskers. I have 12 therapists at my house, 12 cats. Smell your favorite food. For me, it's still Earl Grey tea. Tune in to your ears and your sense of hearing, my voice. For me, it's also the sound of my air filter. Taste, smell, hearing. And now touch, feel your feet or your butt bones if you're seated. Clothing on your body. Let your body feel your clothing. Let your clothing feel your body. If you're wearing glasses, feel those on your face. Feel the inside of your head inside your skull. Let your skull feel your head. And the last sense is vision. It could be if you're tuning into this recording, the video, or you can tune in to something slightly beyond the screen. Tune into those five senses and try and stay present because of my special guest today. And we're just going to play a couple of videos to show you. Welcome back. So I guess if you haven't figured it out, it's Zoe Jakes. We know in the dance community has this amazing, amazing performer, instructor, creative genius. Seriously. All right. But I also know her, but in addition to her being an integral part of Beats Antique, you've got to listen to the music. If you haven't downloaded it already, go do that right now as soon as this podcast is over, right, Zoe? Anyways, but I have known Zoe since my kids were now 22, almost 23. And you met them, oh gosh, so were they like 8 or 9?
It must have been about that age. I still remember the moment where we were all hanging out in the room next to the studio, and it was before I was doing any flexibility training. And they were doing these amazing standing splits, and I was like, "Let me try." It was so freaking cute.
Here's the thing, audience. The thing about Zoe that I absolutely need you to know, right? And she's going to be very humble about this, but she takes life by the horns in this humble, always learning way. And that's not very easy to do because Zoe's in the spotlight in our community all the time. So like she's learning publicly in a very public way.
Yeah.
Right?
Everything.
Yeah. The rest of us kind of get to hide in anonymity, but Zoe's in the spotlight. Like when she got pregnant with her baby, you know, everyone wanted to give her advice. It was all loving, but sometimes, you know, you didn't ask for it and she still got offered it. But if you wouldn't mind sharing with the audience the role of music in your life, because when I first met you, I think you had already been producing your own music.
Yeah, I've been working on music for, I think I really started around like 2005 and 2006 when I started to kind of tinker in the Ableton Live, which is the program I was using to edit and create tracks and build tracks. And I would say the role of music in my life has been one that I can't really trace back to like I was a musician when I was a kid or anything. I was, I played a lot of instruments. I was in bands but really I would say ultimately the moment where I started to understand how important music was to me as a dancer and why I can't dance unless I have at least a decent amount of live interaction, live music in my life is because I always was in dance class as a kid, always. And it was always canned music. It was always like the, you know, you dance to a pre-recorded song and I was never inspired. And I was in dance classes for years. And it wasn't until I was traveling around the country in a van with my cat, you know, working at festivals and I started taking belly dance classes. And there was actually live musicians at these events. That's when my heart was like, what is this? And it was the feeling the music in your body and then being drawn and pushed to interpret it. Just to not even interpret it. Like it wasn't even that much of a thought. It was just, I have to move. And I'd never felt that before in my life. And so that to me was really the moment when I felt like I was becoming a dancer. And so even though I played music and I danced a lot as a kid, you know, just for fun, but also like taking a lot of classes, it really wasn't until I had that feeling, that sensation, that like very primal urge to just move my body to live music that it kind of changed everything.
And I want to ask, when did you begin the process of making your own music? Where did that come from?
So it was when me and David, you know, so Beats Antique is me, David, and Tommy, and me and David were in a relationship for a long time. We were together for 12 years. And I think we got together in like 2004, maybe 2004, I think. And we were very curious as a couple, very curious, very excited about all these things. And he was learning this program called Ableton. And so for me, the programming music, making music, editing music, like all of that stuff, composing music started just as fun with my boyfriend, making music with these programs and finding these samples and him recording himself and then us putting it through these processors and then changing the. So that was really when I started to get into it. And that was really, I think, when I truly became a musician, which is ironic that it was through a computer. When I was a kid, you know, I went to school and I was in band and I played, it wasn't tuba, but it was the second small, it was the baritone, which is really funny.
That's so cool.
Yeah, I played baritone in junior high and high school. And oh man, did I ever get picked on? But I was like, I don't want to play flute. I want to play this thing. And then I needed its own seat on the bus. And it was a pretty funny experience, but I loved it. And I played, you know, I played guitar and piano and all that, but never identifying myself as a musician until I spent a good 2 or 3 years I think of myself as a composer. That is the thing that draws me to music, is like the story that you tell through the instruments interacting with each other.
Yeah. I am always, because the more I listen to the music that you specifically have been really composing, especially lately, the intricacies of it, Zoe, the layering in it. Do you have an idea already of what you're going to do? Or are you still playing, which is integral anyways to growth, when you start a new piece, like that last bit of music that you're unveiling in your current tour, right? That song?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. A lot of songs. Surges, that one that came out, is so pretty. Yeah, we just released a new track, and we're releasing an album here. We've been working on it for a while. And that song, it's so funny. The Surges, the new song, Tommy made this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful like track, and he brought it to the band, and David put this melody on it that just is just heart, is just beautiful. And the thing that I found really interesting about it is the song is very strongly rooted in nostalgia. In my opinion, when I hear it, it makes me think of the good old days, but it's not like a song from 2007, 2008. It's like thick with nostalgia. And I thought it was really interesting, like when the song was coming together and when we were arranging it. But I didn't really quite answer your question. You were asking like my process.
Kind of. Is it when you're coming together with an idea, is it an idea, or are you going, I really want to make this type of, like, how? Got it. I'm sure it's different processes for each different piece and album as it's come along, being affected by your life, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the band works differently through different seasons of our career as the band, and also through different songs. So I can give you a few different examples. There's one song, it's called Viper's Den. Viper's Den, the first half of the song, it was a melody that I wrote, and I actually brought the track to the band. And I want to make something out of this. And so it was me finding this instrument through this program and writing this melody, and it was a very simple, so that whole song started as me writing this melody and then building a track around it and then bringing it partially finished to the band and being like, what do you think of this? But the cool thing about that, and the cool thing about working with David and Tommy, is David was like, that would be so cool as the horn section. So we need like a big band. But he wanted the whole thing to have this big band feel. And I didn't, I was like, I want it to have this like really serpentine kind of spooky feeling in the beginning. And so that's what came out of it. It's like almost two totally different songs, but it's this journey, you know? And so that was that. It was like David bringing in the horn section and then me bringing in this, you know, this very serpentine beginning bit. And the track, when we perform it, it's a story on stage, you know, it's a transformation, just like the track was. Whereas there are other times where David and Tommy will bring a track to me and I'll just help arrange it. I tend to be a bit of an editor in the band. That ends up being a big, one of my big jobs in a lot of the tracks, because I have the perspective of a mover. And as dancers, I think one of the biggest complaints that we have when we hear music is there's no room for us. It's so thick. It's so busy. It's like, what do we have to add to this track? And so for me, there's a lot of simplification. Like I'm the one that, because isn't there like you put on your outfit and you put on all your accessories and you take at least one off before you walk out the front door. Isn't that like a saying? That's how I feel about music. It's like you think it's done and then you don't add anything else, but that's when the editing starts to happen. And so I edit a lot of stuff. I'll go in and be like, you guys, this is too much. This drum thing is crazy. Let's go in here and do this and this and this.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to go back to the Viper's Den.
Yeah.
Can I ask, hopefully it's not too personal question, where did you get the inspiration for that melody?
Okay. It is a long time ago. So I got to think about this. I was envisioning, so this one actually, and this is where what's such a cool thing about the Beats Antique songs that I think very few bands, electronic bands, would ever say anything like this. I had an idea for an act first. I loved the idea of being a snake. And if you've seen the Riper's Den piece, I know you have, I start as a snake with this giant snake cobra headdress that's covered in rhinestones. And I slowly turn. Oh, but now we have to go back a little bit. So I watched this performance and it was a modern dancer. And she started on stage and a piece of silk led into the darkness. And she turned slowly, and the whole song, the only thing she did was turn, and she was slowly wrapped in silk all the way up to her neck. And I was like, that was so powerful. What if it was a snake? So that was the next step. And then I thought, the snake needs a line. And it goes back to this idea of some composers. A famous one was the one where like the composer had each instrument, each classical instrument, Peter and the Wolf, and each instrument represented a different character. And she needed an instrument. And so I wanted to find her voice and what she would sound like. And so that was me looking through Ableton and looking through these music programs and finding this sample that was actually sampled from a live instrument. And so I was trying to make her talk in this kind of spooky, where she was pulling her prey in as she was like twisting around and like hypnotizing them.
I love that. Okay, Zoe. So when you're not making and dancing to Beats Antique stuff, and also folks, Zoe has her own online school and also workshops where you can go in person. I'm doing a performance intensive with Zoe in Portland in February. Dom, who's in our live studio audience, are you signed up for that? Should you sign up so we can hang out? Anyways, all of you are welcome to join us. Okay. When are you? Okay. We'll talk later. We're in the Q&A after this, Dom. One of the things that I love being with Zoe, you guys, is just so you know, I do a lot of intensives, real talk right now, Zoe, real talk. A lot of us, we're learning addicts in the dance world. And anytime anyone's offering a dance intensive, we just max out all of our credit cards and we go to you because we just love it. Many, many instructors. Zoe is one of the few people over the years consistently, always, I have always felt uplifted, guided, and she's always patient with you. That's not easy when you're working with multi-levels of dancers. Some of us are beginning adult learners, you know, of movement. Some of us are, they come from ballet backgrounds. And Zoe has to mesh all of us into this congruent performance entity on stage. We did a video in Oakland last month, right, Zoe?
Speaking of which, I have an edit to show you soon.
Sorry, focus, Jenny. I can't wait for that. Yeah. And so Zoe, when you're not doing all of this and also being a mom, she has a little baby who is so precious and growing up so quickly. You guys, she's two. Anyhow, what is your preferred music that you listen to that you, when you need to heal and center, what do you listen to?
Okay. So the music that feeds me is music that makes me want to move, period. And so my two favorite artists right now that are blowing my mind, one is Feverkin. Yes. Go anything. Just go and go buy their music. Go buy it if they have it in Bandcamp so they get as much money as possible. And the other artist is Apache. I think I'm pronouncing it properly. Apache, he's a DJ and he's incredible. Just check out his work. He is mind blowing. He's an incredible artist. His work is just astounding, and definitely support him and all the people that are part of his group. So those are the two people that are blowing my mind, because every time I hear their music, I'm just like, oh my God, it's telling me how I want to move. And that's the stuff that makes me feel like I'm healing.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Okay. So don't forget, audience, to tune into the music that inspires Zoe, and because Zoe inspires us, right? I want to ask one more question. We have about a minute left. Okay. So if you could, because you have a lot of wisdom to share, even though you're very humble about it. How would you encourage people who are kind of afraid of moving to music in like 30 seconds or less? We'll just have her back again, you guys, but how would you encourage people to try?
The biggest thing that I see is when people are able to just say to themselves one small step, one little thing. It doesn't have to be some huge, massive, I'm taking this crazy dance intensive. There's so many wonderful online options. There's so many different styles of dancers and teachers. You can just sign up for a class. You can turn the video off and move. And then just that alone, just taking those little baby steps. There's plenty of YouTube options for like free if you just want to take a look and move. And then really for me, the biggest piece of advice I would recommend is like, just regardless of what genre of music it is, the piece of music that truly feeds your soul and your mind and your heart, just playing it and closing your eyes and seeing what happens to your breathing and just sitting with that to me alone. It seems like a simple step, but I feel like that's a great way to get in touch with your movement.
Thank you. Thank you, Zoe, for taking the time out on your tour to come in. Thank you, audience. Tune in to her online website that will be in the description. Thanks so much for joining us. I'll see you in 2 weeks.
Thank you, Jenny.
Thanks for listening to Dance to Heal with Jenny C. Cohen. Come back next time to hear stories of recovery through movement and learn more ways that you can move your body. To work with me and continue your journey, visit outsideinrecovery.com. Are you ready to move?